And you may be seated. And if you have a song sheet, we will now be lighting the first two. And where is my other LaFleur? Is she way in the back? There, I need one more LaFleur girl. So the two LaFleur girls will be lighting the candles, and Molly's going to be helping me over here. Molly, why don't you sneak on over here while we're waiting for Sophia? And if you have the song sheets, you can get ready. We're going to be doing the intro, and then Cammy is going to do the reading. There. And if you can't reach the candle, we'll throw you up, okay? All right? All right. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Drop down dew from heaven, and let the clouds rain down the just one. You remove the wall which sin had raised between God and us. Through you we have regained access to God. Our own hearts too, O Lord, are often dark and sinful.
We cry to you,
Holy Spirit,
come
and save us. Okay. Oh. You can hold on to that. Okay, Cammy, you want to try, or are we going to take that down? I think we'll take it down. There we go. Just hold on to that for one sec. And Sophia, if you want to get that one in there. Beautiful. Okay. And Cammy, if you'd like to do your reading.
Peace I live with you. My peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. I'm afraid. As we await the coming of the Prince of Peace, we need to think about peacemaking in our everyday lives. How many disputes or arguments would end quickly with a simple apology? Peacemaking is a blessing that will eventually reap rewards, so not be troubled or afraid to take the first step.
Very nice. Thank you, both Sophia and Cammy. All right. Okay, we're going to go back. Oh, maybe you want to be an altar girl too? All right. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God, the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we realize the true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we unite ourselves with you through the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, that by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Welcome again to our church, and this is the second Sunday of Advent, and we're four Sundays long, so we're getting a little bit more light, and we have just lit the candle of peace. So we now have hope and peace as part of our Advent message. Last night, Sharon and I, we went to a concert down at Smith College. It was very nice, but there was a little bit of a typo problem, and they put the third piece first and the first piece third. And so as we're listening to the first piece, I'm sitting there, and I don't know much about Greek, and it was very beautiful. And I said, oh great, I like Greek, I guess. And so then they come back after the intermission, and they let us know about the mistake in the printing. And that first piece that I thought was Greek was Mendelssohn. I like Mendelssohn. He's kind of, it's like a full sound. It's a beautiful, lot of strings and everything else. And so there was a surprise. You know, we're sitting there so sophisticated. We're listening to classical music, and we don't even know which composer is being played at the time, but it was beautiful anyway. And so that kind of message of surprise is something that I come across constantly in this Advent time of preparation, because God just surprised us so much by the way that he came into the world in that little child instead of with power and glory and might. And I think that's one of the messages that we need to keep in mind throughout Advent, that message that God is constantly out there surprising us. And we're going to have a couple of surprises during the liturgy today, because I'm fighting some kind of a chest cold. And so I'm going to try and get as much of the Mass out as I can, but if my voice doesn't stay with me, some of the sung parts will be turning into recited parts. And so good luck, choir, keeping up. Just wish them luck, but we'll do the best that we can. And as I always tell you, I offer you the Holy Communion, but you know, I try to keep my hands away from my mouth and all that. I don't want to pass on any germs to anybody, but please make that choice yourself about whether you want to come forward or not, because I am trying to fight off something. So as we do gather at this time for the celebration of Mass, as I said, with hope and peace as part of our theme, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. May we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the inmost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you patiently all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. Amen. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
Amen.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established to remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice.
Amen.
And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever. Let us pray. Almighty Father, send your Son once again to judge the secrets of our human hearts. May we, who in holy fear await his coming as judge, joyfully regard him as our Savior. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah. A shoot shall come out from the stock of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lay down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox, the nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up a righteous shoot to David. As king, he shall reign and govern wisely, shall do what is just and right in the land. Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Let us fall into the hands of the Lord, not into the hands of men. For equal to his majesty is the mercy that he shows.
Alleluia,
alleluia. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. You cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. In those days, John the Baptist appeared, preaching in the desert of Judea. And he said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." It was of him that the prophet Isaiah had spoken when he said, "A voice of one crying out in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths." John wore clothing made of camel's hair and had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. At that time, Jerusalem and all of Judea and the whole region around the Jordan were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they acknowledged their sins. And when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees coming to his baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce good fruit as evidence of your repentance. And do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you, God can raise up children to Abraham from these very stones. Even now the axe lies at the root of the trees. Therefore every tree that does not bear good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I am baptizing you with water for repentance, but the one who is coming after me is mightier than I. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand. He will cleanse or clear the threshing floor and gather his wheat into his barn, but the chaff he will burn with an unquenchable fire." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
A shoot shall sprout from the stump of Jesse. That's much taken from this morning's lesson in the Old Testament book of prophet Isaiah. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The last Sunday, we drove Amanda back after her Thanksgiving break back to college, and we had our dog Mason with us. And we had to pull into a rest stop in Vermont to walk the beast. And at the back of the rest stop, there was a gate that was slightly ajar that led out to this beautiful, rolling, grassy hill. And so I took Mason through the gate and decided we'd climb to the top of one of those hills and take a look around. As I'm walking, I'm starting to notice some rather large deposits of, for lack of a more polite term, fertilizer. And my first thought is that others must have done the same thing I did. They were driving along and they decided to walk their pets there too. And then as I continue, still walking towards the summit of that hill, I remember we're in rural Vermont. Maybe that fertilizer wasn't from pets. Maybe I was in somebody's pasture. And then I remember Eddie Jablonski's wife, after he passed away, gave me this bright, bright red Red Sox jacket that I'm wearing. I'm still walking towards the summit of the hill, and I have to admit, I don't know anything about animals at all, you know? And so I'm walking towards the top of that hill, and I'm wondering, on the other side of that hill, what if I come across a bull who's not too happy about some stranger walking through his pasture, and to boot, I've got this bright red jacket on. So as I'm walking up the hill, I'm looking behind me. It doesn't seem all that far to get to where I was. It was a leisurely, easy walk. But I'm thinking, if there really is an angry bull on the other side, that's a real long way to run back to get to that gate. So such perceptions, I guess, they depend on your circumstances. A leisurely walk, no big deal. Running from an angry bull, it's a long way to go. And that's where I'd like to begin talking about this morning's message of peace. Mary Ellen read for us a passage from the prophet Isaiah. He was preaching at a time when the Jewish people were in an absolutely desperate situation. They were on the verge of complete defeat. They were going to lose their country. Their king was going to be gone. They were going to lose their temple. That was the center of their worship. They really did not have a plan for how to worship God without the temple. Everything they trusted in, everything they believed in, everything was going to be lost. And into this confusion, God sends his prophet. And I think a lot of those people in Israel, there's even evidence in the Bible that they were expecting this prophet to come with a message from God that, don't worry, as bad as things look, I will not let that happen. But the prophet instead is extremely blunt. Defeat is inevitable, he says, but new possibilities will arise out of destruction. That's one of those key Advent messages. No matter how bleak things are, no matter how bad they are, God can raise something good out of it. It's about new beginnings, and that's what Advent is. The old must give way before the new can be put in place. And that image of the prophet that he uses to convey this message of new beginnings is that one of the stump of a tree. And out of that apparently dead wood, says Isaiah, a shoot shall sprout from the stump of Jesse. And then the wolf will lie down with the lamb. The lion shall eat hay like the ox. And circumstances were so terribly bad, so unimaginably bad, that people could not imagine any way out except that God has to directly intervene. God has to change everything immediately. God has to do it all for us because it's so bad we can't do it ourselves. And then John the Baptist, 600 years later, he picks up this imagery when he says to us today that the axe lies at the root of the tree. And still with John, 6 centuries later, Israel remains in desperate straits. It's been 6 centuries, and they still don't have a king to call their own. And on top of that, there is a rebuilt and massive temple in Jerusalem. But John leaves all of that behind. John's from a priestly family. He could have been working in that temple. He leaves all of that behind. And he says that its worship, its place, its leadership, they're all tainted. They're all impure. They're not of God. And there's still hope for a Savior, he says, who is going to change everything for us. He will gather all of the righteous, and at the same time, he will destroy all of the wicked. And John, just like Isaiah 6 centuries before, continues that message that God is going to do it all for us. But it's Advent, and we're preparing ourselves instead for the coming of the Christ child. Not as completely other, but surprisingly, as exactly one of us. Jesus comes as us. I'm hoping that we can begin to see through the comparison of these prophecies with actual history that God has surprised us in the way that he entered into the world, in the way that he's trying to change the world, in the way that he's trying to change us. A friend shared with me a tip about a book called Brightsided, which is a play on the phrase broadsided. Broadsided is a harsh, extreme, and unexpected attack. It's when somebody gets caught off guard by this attack, and it's the premise of the book is that that same kind of unexpected destruction can take place through that now current rage of the power simply of positive thinking. Positive thinking becomes something almost magical. All you have to do is think about the possibility, and somehow with all these powerful, wonderful thoughts coming out of us, it will happen. Reprogram your mind with images that you dream of being, and all of a sudden, it will become that way. What you will yourself to be, you will be. Now, this can lead, however, in the opposite direction, because there's a difference between optimism and hope. Optimism is the belief that things will get better on their own. Hope, on the other hand, hope is one of the virtues of God. It comes from God, that if we work hard enough with hope, things will get better. But the thing is, we have to work with God. Hope is an active virtue that is empowered by God. It's not only the optimism of believing things will improve, it's working to help them improve because we believe that God has empowered us and that when we're empowered by God, we can do amazing things, things that would even surprise us. And for our proof for this hope, we have Jesus as us. I think after all those 600 years of prophecies that God was going to do it for us, and then comes Jesus, we have to face the reality that if anything is going to be done, God says, and this is that surprising message of Advent, he says, you can do it. When Isaiah and John the Baptist were confronted with total failure, they countered with a solution that totally everything had to be in the hands of God. But in the reality, their prophecies were not the magical transformation that led to butterflies, flowers, and rainbows everywhere. There was the transformation instead that points to what we can be. And you know, there's so many times in this world where we think everything is terrible, that we think all people are terrible, we think society is terrible, we think there's no way out, we want God to take care of everything, and Advent comes along and says, we can be better. That's hard. That means it's work. That means that we have to struggle against the tide. But that's exactly what Advent is. And in a few days' time, we're going to gather for the Feast of Divine Love, where we see that God gives us a beautiful creation. We can mess it up. We can turn that beautiful creation into all kinds of sin and dirt and everything else. But God has given us the ability in creation and in our souls and in our spirits. We can do it, but we have to work with God. So Christmas lets us believe that Jesus was and is one of us. And when we believe in that revelation, then we can see what we can be. We can see what is possible. And all of a sudden, we're changed. And that's not only optimism, that's hope. And hope comes from God. In Advent, we imagine peace on earth. And we all do that through the promise of Jesus' birth. And we need to realize that God ain't going to do it for us. That he has entered into the fray himself in Jesus, and that with Jesus as our faith and Jesus leading us, you know, peace, that second candle over there, peace is possible. Candy told us at the beginning of Mass, as we await the coming of the Prince of Peace, we need to think about peacemaking in our everyday lives. How many disputes or arguments would end quickly with a simple apology? Peacemaking is a blessing that will eventually reap rewards. So be not troubled or afraid to take that first step. We can't throw in the towel. Remember that gate story in my bright red jacket? Perception depends a lot on circumstance, and our circumstances make all that peace and everything else seem kind of unlikely. Our circumstances are instead of constant wars, and now we live in a time of increasing civic and social tension as well. Animosity is increasing, and differences are not being tolerated by people, too many people. I went to make my first Friday visitation. I go over to I can't remember what the name of that nursing home was in Sunderland. What's Cozy Corner called now? I forgot. New England Health. So I go over there, And, you know, there's a lot of people of color that work in there, you know, with the staff and everything. I go, and I'm walking back to my car after bringing communion to Anna Novak, and on the, I don't know, there's a the front dashboard, and whatever you call the back, you know, by the rear window of a car, there's a red hat there, and on the hat, it says, "Make America White Again." I mean, when you start seeing that stuff being advertised by people, you know, right up here where, you know, you see three people of color, if you're lucky, in a day. When you start seeing signs like that, even here in Sunderland, South Deerfield, Conway, Waitley, of Make America White Again, we've really got some real problems out there. People of color are not evil, and we have to realize that differences are not bad. We have to be surprised again of what we can be and not what we have to be. So in these circumstances, it seems so unreasonable to expect peace, but that's exactly what we need to do when we think about the coming child. He was peace amid a world that was filled with hatred and violence. He made peace his priority because he saw God more clearly than he saw anything else, and that's how he could change his life and his world, and when we follow him, we can change our lives and our world. So Christmas gives us hope, that we can work to make peace possible. And may this be our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather on this, the second Sunday of Advent, as we're about halfway through our journey of preparation for that mystery and the wonder that is Christmas, we offer our prayers in memory of Donnie Herzig. Wednesday, December 7th, would have been his 55th birthday. We also offer prayers in memory of Florence Mietlitzki on the anniversary of her birth, which is today, December 4th, as offered by her daughter, Shirley Mietlitzki Floyd. We offer prayers for Peter Sokop on the 34th anniversary of his death, December 4th, 1982. It's offered by Mark, Barbara, David, Daniel, and Robert Stahelski. We offer our prayers in loving memory of Teddy Morosky, Vinny Profito, Peter and Betty Orlovsky, and Beatrice Morosky, all passed in the month of December. It's offered by the Orlovsky and Profito families. We continue to offer our prayers for the following who are battling cancer: Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Sprosky, Brandy Clements by grandmother Dottie Veronis, fathers Ray Drada and Maurice Lazelle, as offered by myself, Richard Poe, as offered by the Poe and Foster families, 2-year-old Jack Seal, as offered by Marianna Foster, and Frank Sprosky, as offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. We also offer prayers for Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, and Liz Bridgman, diagnosed with cancer, raising 3 young girls on her own, and those prayers being offered by Cindy Benjamin. Are there other prayers that you would like to offer from the congregation?
I'd like to offer prayers for the health of my brother-in-law who had open heart surgery and
And his name?
Jim Devine.
Jim Devine, okay. Any others? All set? For all of these prayers, Lord, plus the ones that we keep in the privacy of our thoughts before your altar, we also ask you, Lord, to hear these and to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to bless those who are parish who are unable to be with us here today, and to bless those who are parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified by the Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism and forgiveness of sins. I look to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Then I called in the name of the Lord. O Lord, save my life. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacrament of blood. Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be accepted to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the hope and the peace that you have given us, and implore you to accept this oblation that we now offer to you. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thank you.
well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. For through the promised sending of Jesus Christ to earth for us, you revealed your goodness and unending love. Sharing in the hope of patriarchs and prophets, may we worthily prepare a dwelling place for the coming Messiah in our hearts. Therefore, with the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, employing you to defend and guide it throughout the world, together with your priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite the Spirit with all of those, even the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood. Just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those whom he had loved in a singular way, and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. And after these other words of the archpriestly prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask, O Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who are in light, stray from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence.
Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused for my judgment, though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it last and I be entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns of God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, that you save from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to speak, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
The body and the blood of Christ.
to you, fear not, I will help you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you chose John the Baptist to call us to repentance and to announce the nearness of God's kingdom. May we, whom your Son, have gathered around this table, praise and glorify you, and proclaim your name before all the world. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. You, most holy Trinity, grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered, through Christ our Lord. May the almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came to be, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life of the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. Any who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willing, but by God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son, coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.